Welcome to Crossroads.
Crossroads Church க்கு உங்களை அன்புடன் வரவேற்கிறோம்.
Bem-vindos a Crossroads.
Welcome to Crossroads International Church of Basel.
Bienvenidos a Crossroads.
Welcome to Crossroads.
Good morning to Crossroads International Church. We're happy that you're with us on Crossroads TV. This is going to be a time in digging into God's Word and worshiping together. Pastor Tony, who is with me, you've been gone for a little while to your home country, Nigeria.
Correct.
What was that for?
So I actually went for my brother's wedding. That's my older brother. He got married and it was pretty good to be there. And also it's the first time in about 12 years that my entire family has been in the same place. So I was actually quite fortunate and blessed to be there together with them. And we had quite a great time together.
And your brother is married?
Yeah, he's happily married.
You bought yourself a nice...
Yes, I did.
African shirt?
Correct. Yeah, I really like it.
And what we also want to know is, do you have footage of having yourself dancing at the wedding?
Oh, I mean, it's an African wedding. There's lots of dancing, right? So okay. Yeah, I have some footage of that.
Vina,
yeah.
Who is Pastor Tony's wife, we want that footage. So if you can take care of that. Yeah. Do you have something else to tell?
Yes, also we have the annual general meeting next week, Sunday at 7 p.m. You can watch this on YouTube, and if you remember, you're also going to get a Zoom link to participate. So I'd like to encourage you to please join. There'll be some issues to vote on, and it will be a good opportunity for us to all connect again. And registration for the Radiant Youth Summer Camp is still going on. It's filling up quite fast. So if you haven't already signed up, please sign up quickly. And as usual, we still have our youth meetings on Sunday evenings. So I would like to encourage all our young ones to come out. Let's fellowship together and have a good time.
Okay. Let's prepare our hearts to worship the Lord and just enter in with us as we engage with what the Lord has for us this morning. We are gathering online this morning, but there's also an in-person service happening at 11:15. For this morning, you cannot sign up for it anymore, as you have to pre-register. But for next week, you've got another chance to come to an in-person service. These are small, with only 50 people maximum. And you have to pre-register through the link in the weekly newsletter or through our website. I want to read the word with you that Pastor David is going to preach about later today. It is from Acts 11, starting at verse 19. It says, "The church in Antioch. Now those who had been scattered by the persecution in connection with Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, telling the message only to Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. News of this reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. And when he arrived and saw the evidence of the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. During this time, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them, named Agabus, stood up and through the Spirit predicted that a severe famine would spread over the entire Roman world. And this happened during the reign of Claudius. The disciples, each according to his ability, decided to provide help for the brothers living in Judea. This they did, sending their gifts to the elders by Barnabas and Saul." This is the word of God. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, as we gather this morning and we're going to study your word, we pray that you will use the words of the scriptures and the words of Pastor David to speak to us, to remind us of your goodness, remind us of the power of the gospel as it goes forth in this world. And I just pray that you will challenge us this morning through your Holy Spirit. That's what we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
My name is Lisa. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my story. So I grew up in the States. I have one brother. We were a family of four. And although I had a great childhood, very supportive parents, and a lot of privileges, I didn't have any exposure to church. My parents were taken to church when they were growing up, but at a certain point they decided that wasn't for them, and so my brother and I really weren't taken. I don't know what I would have said if you had asked me, what I knew about Jesus or even what I thought about God. I went off to university, and that was probably the first time that I encountered some people that I knew went to church regularly, had a couple friends that went, and they didn't always go on Sunday. I guess they were Catholic, so they sometimes went on Friday evening or Sunday night, and I thought that was unusual because I thought church people went on Sundays. But I never had an interest to go, and they never invited me. When I went to graduate school following that, I ended up living with two young women, one who was a family friend, the daughter of my father's closest friend in college, and they had lived about 3 hours away from us throughout my childhood, and so I saw them on summer holidays and was quite close to her. She also grew up in a family that didn't take them to church, but in her teenage years, she was exposed to a youth group in a local church, and she got very involved and became a Christian, she and her sister. And so when I went to live at university, at grad school with her, she and her roommate were both Christians, and they started praying for me and wanting, you know, me to become a Christian. And I didn't know that at the time, but they invited me to go with them on Sunday mornings to the college church, the church in the university town. And I didn't really have a reason not to go. So I said, well, yeah, sure, why not? I'll go on Sunday mornings. When I first went, I noticed that these people in the church, they just seemed different. There was something about them, something that I found attractive and interesting. And so I was curious to know more about that. Fortunately, it was really an evangelical church, and it didn't take long before I heard that what they had was the Holy Spirit living in them, and that I could have that too, that was something that was offered to me through Jesus and his saving work. And so after a month or so, I wanted to be a Christian, and I remember talking to my friends and praying one night on my own, and asking God to come and save me. I can't really imagine what it would be like to go through life to raise children. We've almost raised four children. We've raised three, one still in the house, and just the challenges along the way with families, with work, all the challenges. I can't imagine how people who don't know that God is always with them and that God guides and leads and that he cares about us and that he has purposes and plans for us, just all the promises that God has made to us and that are recorded in the Bible. I can't imagine surviving in life without knowing for sure that all those things are truth, that there is absolute truth, and God's word is true. I can't imagine how people get by without knowing that.
I will bless. Are you missing travel? Are you ready to get out of the city and go somewhere new? I know that I am desiring to explore some new part of the world. One thing I know about this congregation is we like to travel. And many of us maybe have had a quick trip back home, or some haven't been able to even do that. But few of us been able to go on a vacation or go to travel or explore someplace new. And we're missing that. And because the COVID restrictions could last into the summer and not everybody's been vaccinated, we're not even sure when we're going to have the opportunity to do that kind of leisure travel again. So I thought it would be good if we took a trip together. And I would like to take you on a journey through the pages of the Bible. Now, I know that sounds a little bit corny. But what I mean specifically by that is I would like to look at Paul's journeys through Asia and Europe, sometimes what we call Paul's missionary journeys, where he establishes new churches, builds up the church, ministers to new converts. It's really the expansion of the church. And each week we're going to go through a different city, a different place where we find Paul and his co-workers together. And we're going to look at what was happening in that location and what God was doing in that spot. And so kind of the middle section of the book of Acts. And why am I wanting to look at that now? Well, partly, yeah, to get out of the city, look at some new places, but also because it's time, I think, for us to have some new vision and some new direction as a church going forward into this next season, whatever it's going to be like. I don't know when the COVID restrictions are really going to change significantly. And in fact, we may have to learn to live with many restrictions going forward. And the world has changed, but our mission hasn't changed. And we just need to learn, how are we going to do church? How are we going to be on mission? How are we going to grow and expand what God has given into our care here in Basel in these next few years? We can't just hit the pause button and do nothing. And so I'm really thinking and praying about what lies ahead. And I think looking at how the church expanded in those very early years may give us some insights and some clues and some passion to see God move in our midst in new and fresh ways. How can we reach English-speaking people in the greater Basel area? How can we do that better? How can we see more people come into his kingdom and into relationship with a heavenly Father? God still loves people. And our life-changing message is still that Jesus is Lord, that he's Savior of the world, and God wants to draw people into relationship with himself. And so over this next couple of months, before the spring break, we're going to talk a lot about vision and direction and what God has in store for us as a congregation at Crossroads, even in the midst of these current days and whatever lies ahead. So we're going to look at this New Testament expansion and ask God to help us see what he has for us. And our journey then begins in the book of Acts in chapter 11 in the city of Antioch. And Antioch was about 700 miles north of Jerusalem, just inland a little bit from the Mediterranean Sea. It's now the modern Turkish city of Antakya. And in the New Testament times, it was the third largest city in the Roman Empire, and often referred to as part of Syria. And it was a Greek city. Remember that the Greek Empire came first. Alexander the Great spread around the Mediterranean Sea and spread the Greek language. And then after that period came the Romans out of what's now Italy. And although they took over much of the empire, still many places were Greek. And the Greek culture and the Greek language was still formidable and entrenched in that part of the world. And in the city of Antioch, you had Greek people. There was a large community of Jews. You now had Roman people and people from all over the world. It was very cosmopolitan. That is, it was very multicultural and incredibly diverse. It was a city of commerce and trade, being close to the Mediterranean, but it was also a seat of government power and the capital of a province there. So it was a very significant city and incredibly different from Jerusalem, which was a tiny little backwater place in those days. This was a major international city. And as the early church was developing in Jerusalem, we know from the earlier chapters in the book of Acts that there was great persecution. And persecution didn't mean that they were limited on how many people could come to their services or that they had to wear masks while they gathered together. No, persecution for them meant that people were being arrested and killed because of the message of Jesus Christ. Their lives were in danger. Their families were in danger because of the message. In Acts chapter 7, we read of the stoning of Stephen, one of the deacons in the church. And in that passage, we meet somebody named Saul, who were told, watched and approved of the execution of Stephen. And then in chapter 8, it says this, Saul approved the killing of him, that is Stephen. And on that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. And all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. So because of this persecution that broke out because of Saul, Christians decided to get out of the city. We can't stay here. This is not safe. They were refugees fleeing for their lives, much as we see today, people fleeing because of their ethnicity or because of their religion or because of war. They went looking for life somewhere else. They didn't know if it would be permanent or temporary, but off they went because Jerusalem was no longer safe for them. And we pick up their story in Acts chapter 11 then, beginning at verse 19. Now those that had been scattered by persecution that broke out when Stephen was killed traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, spreading the word only among the Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to the Greeks also, telling them the good news from the Lord Jesus. And the Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. There are three things that I want you to notice about this church in Antioch this morning as we start. And the first one is this, that this church was birthed in the midst of a crisis. This is how the church got started. There was no big plan. There was no committee. There was no denominational oversight. The church in Jerusalem didn't say, now, where should we start a second location? Should we be multi-service or anything like that? No, the church was birthed in the midst of a crisis because there was persecution and people had to flee to a different place. And we tend to think that in the midst of a crisis, this is a poor time to start something new. I mean, let's just hang on and survive. And indeed, people left Jerusalem thinking, you know, they weren't thinking. Rather, when they went, you know, let's go and start another church, they just were thinking, we need to get out of here. But in the midst of that crisis, they couldn't help but tell other people about Jesus, and they couldn't help but sort of give a reason for their hope, and people started getting saved. And this new church was formed out of the persecution, out of the crisis that had come, because God moved in a very significant way. What Saul had meant for evil, what the enemy was against, God was using for something good. And we'll see in this series that we look at different churches, many of them get started in different ways. People come to faith in different ways. Paul is often led by the Spirit, in some cases intentional about where he goes and to what city, and in other cases by accident, so it seems. In some cases, it's in the heart of men and women that God would be at work. But here, God was just at work in the midst of the crisis that they were facing. And so here's the question I've been asking. You know, what can God do in our midst in this COVID crisis? Should we just be sitting things out and saying, well, can't do anything in a crisis, we'll just have to wait till this is over? Or do we believe that God has something for our church, that God can move, that people can be saved, that our church can continue to grow in the midst of a COVID crisis? Why do we think that that limits God in doing his work? We can't limit the Spirit and the work that God wants to do in our midst. And, you know, we can't say, well, nothing's going to happen until we get back to this kind of service or until we can do this again. You know, God has never been restricted in that way, and he's not limited like we are in our thinking. Saul is out tracking people down to kill them, and as a result, there's a whole new church birthed in a city. And we don't even know who those people were. They're not named. We're not told who those people were. They were just faithful men and women of God who were living their life before the Lord. We read through Acts and we tend to think that Paul or Peter or one of the apostles started all of these churches. But we'll discover in many places things were already happening. There were other people that were already taking the gospel, and they're not named as such, but their work is recorded in Scripture. And we don't know who started many of these things. Luke, as the writer of Acts, is focusing this section on Saul, on Paul. He had been focused on the church in Jerusalem and Peter's ministry, and now it shifts to Paul's ministry. But many of the people, you know, as the church is expanding, we're only looking at Paul's ministry to the north and to the west. But remember, the church is also expanding south into Africa, into Ethiopia, and across Persia and into India. So the church is expanding out of that center, but we just have one small picture that's been recorded for us. But everywhere there are faithful men and women just serving the Lord, just sharing Jesus, and helping to build the church. And in this case, it's in less than favorable conditions. And so I think there's a lesson for us here. Should we be expecting nothing to happen during this time, or do we believe that God wants to build his church during a pandemic season in Switzerland? We don't have to hit the pause button. I don't think COVID can stop God from being at work in our midst just because our Sundays look so different. It might be through a move of his Spirit, or it might be because we're taking time to pray and to plan and to listen to him. But I think we ought to be expecting that God wants to be at work even in the midst of a crisis, and that nothing can stop God from his church going forward. And that's the first thing we learn about the church in Antioch. The second thing I want you to notice about this church is that it was very different from the church in Jerusalem. And Luke focuses on this. It really changes the direction and the makeup of the universal church for all of history. By the way, some of the commentators think that Luke was from Antioch, but it's not something we're 100% sure of, but he never really says, but it's interesting if that was his home. What changes in the early church is that these unnamed people that went to Antioch spoke not only to Jews, but it says they also spoke to Greeks, the Hellenists, and they were preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and many believed and turned to the Lord. Now, this is a great shift. Who are the Greeks, or in some translation, the Hellenists? There's a specific word that Luke uses here. He's not just meaning sort of all the pagan people, but maybe those that were God-fearers, those that were interested in the Jewish religion, those that were closer to Jews. They're not Jews, but they're Greek, not only language, but culturally. And so they started to reach out to people that were not from a Jewish background. Now, we know in Acts chapter 6 that within the Jewish community, there are already two groups. There were Hebrew-speaking Jews and Greek-speaking Jews. And it wasn't just a language difference. There were cultural differences there that separated them. And as they were forming the early church, they had to learn how to become brothers and sisters in Christ. But they were still under that sort of Jewish background. But here, this is different. It's moving into the Greek, into the Gentile community. And it's crossing the line from sort of people that have an understanding of the Old Testament and what that's about to people that totally have no background at all in the gospel, in the Old Testament, or the work of God, or who God even was. And so this was a significant development because the church in Jerusalem said, whoa, people that aren't Jews are becoming Christians? We should check this out. We're not sure that that's right. We don't know if that's going to be allowed. But God was expanding the vision of his world. Jesus said, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And he wasn't just talking about where Jewish people lived. He was saying that all people are going to come to me. I'm here for the whole world. And in Acts chapter 13, we have a list of some of the leaders in the church in Antioch. Now, in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers. Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaea, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. Now, Barnabas, we know, was from Cyprus. He was a Jew, but he wasn't part of the Jewish, the Jerusalem leadership. Simeon, called Niger, which means black, was probably a black African. Definitely, Lucius from Cyrene was from North Africa, where Libya is now. Manaea had been raised with Herod the Tetrarch. He had been raised in the royal court. He had connection with government and politics. And so you have this very diverse group of people from different parts of the world, different times, different cultures, different skin colors, different social levels. Here you have one guy who's connected with the ruler over the area, and then other people that are tradesmen and businessmen and religious teachers. And you have this incredible mix. It was kind of the first international church that existed. It was the first significant church outside Jerusalem, and it was multicultural and international. They included people from different parts of the world who didn't have a Jewish background, who came from different social statuses, and it was started by people that weren't even from that city. They maybe were living there temporary, or some of them might have stayed permanently, but it wasn't their city. This was an expat church. This was an international expat church. People that weren't from there went there, started a church, brought in all kinds of foreigners, local Syrians as well would be part of that congregation, and they formed something new that the world hadn't seen before as they formed community together. Out of that expat church of internationals, there would be a missions movement that would travel around the world and change the face of the church forever. And hey, you know what? We're an international expat church. We're full of internationals who came to this place from other places. We have over 50 different nationalities and many different languages and a whole lot of different cultures. And, you know, we have different skin color and we think differently. We have different church denominational backgrounds. Some people had no church background before they came here. And, you know, God has put us together for his glory to do something new in this world. We have a wide range of people in the economic scale and political views and aspirations and connections. We also are this diverse international expat group of people, just like the church in Antioch. And so my question is, can God use a church like this? Does God have a plan for a group of people like this? Can we see a mission out of this mix of mutts that we all are? I think that's worth asking, and I'm encouraged when I see that God can use the church in Antioch, you know, that God can use this church as well. So this church in Antioch gets started out of a crisis. People are excited. They're telling everyone about Jesus, even the Gentiles. They get saved. People in Jerusalem are going like, I don't know if that's allowed, and they've got to check it out. This international church was shaking things up. So the church in Jerusalem wanted to investigate. Greeks were getting saved? Okay, we need to check it out. They send a guy named Barnabas, who's from Cyprus, to check it out. And what does it say in the scripture? He saw the grace of God. That's a beautiful line. He walked into that fellowship and he just knew it was the grace of God. God was at work here. he was in the midst of something wonderful that was happening. There was not false teaching. This wasn't manipulation. It wasn't a multi-level marketing scheme. It wasn't an expat club of some kind. This was the work of God. And he just marveled at the grace of God. You know, wait, something's happening here. People are getting saved, and they've never heard of Jehovah before, but they're coming to faith in Jesus Christ, and they're being baptized in the Spirit, and they're growing in their faith. And he just saw something so very exciting there, and he says, this needs help. So he goes to Tarsus to find this guy named Saul, who sometimes we call Paul, but his name yet hasn't been changed. So in chapter 7 and 8, we see Saul as the persecutor of the church. In chapter 9, Saul has an encounter with Jesus and gets saved. And yet his own life is in danger because now he's threatened by many people because he has become a believer. And so the church in Jerusalem sends him to Tarsus, where he will be safe and where he will be out of the way. And it's possible that Paul spent about 10 years in Tarsus. We don't know entirely what he was doing during that time, but it wasn't yet time for him to take leadership in this way. And so he's waiting there, but Barnabas knew him, and Barnabas said, I'm going to go get Saul. I think he can help here in Antioch. And so it says for a full year, the two of them ministered in that church and discipled and led and gave leadership to that church. And it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. It was fitting because they followed Christ. If you followed Herod, you were Herodian. If you followed Christ, you were a Christian. I think this was happening. This group was growing, and people were like, who are those strange people, and what is their religion? Well, they're followers of Christ. We'll call them Christians. And this label has stuck. The third thing, then, I want you to notice about this congregation there is that they were led by the Spirit. They were open to the leading of God's Spirit. And I want you to catch that, because nobody had planned what was going on in Antioch. Nobody had a strategy for taking the gospel to the ends of the earth or even building a church there. This was the move of God, and the people responded to that. They were faithful. They let the Spirit lead them, and were given two occasions and told about two occasions when this happened. One is in chapter 11, verse 27. There was a prophet, Agabus, who foretold of a coming famine over the world. And Luke tells us it did happen during the time of Claudius. And the church received this prophecy, and they felt we should help the people in Jerusalem and Judea. They take an offering which showed their immense generosity and foresight, but they responded. They took God's word seriously and said, if there's going to be a crisis, we need to plan and do something. And they responded to the leading of the Spirit to help those in need. But the second leading of the Spirit was more significant in Acts chapter 13, in verses 2 and 3. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. This is the key moment in the beginning of these missionary journeys that we're about to read, and the beginning of so many churches and so much of our New Testament, which Paul comes to write. How did the Holy Spirit speak to them? Luke didn't tell us. I wish that he did. I wish we knew how that was. Was it through the word of one of the prophets that was there in the church? Or was it something that Saul and Barnabas felt in their heart? Did it come out of discussion around other places that still needed the gospel, and the people from other countries were saying, well, my city hasn't been reached yet? But there was a sense amongst the people that the Spirit of God was leading them to set Barnabas and Saul apart so that they could go and travel to other places and take the gospel message and plant churches in new places. And they really felt that this was the Spirit, and it was the Spirit that was setting these two apart, and they weren't going to stand in the way of it. And there was a unity there because they knew that God was at work. One of the things we'll look at in this series is, how does God speak to his church? How do we discern what God is asking of us? Of course, he's speaking to us, I believe, right now through this scripture that I'm sharing this morning. The question is, are we listening and hearing what he has to say? He leads through his word. But as we see in Acts chapter 15, it's not always a word from the sky that shouts down at us. In the Council of Jerusalem, they had to debate and discuss and deliberate and pray and fast. Sometimes we'll discover there were signs and wonders or dreams that took place that was the leading of the Spirit and then confirmed by those that were around. But they did know and they did recognize and they wanted to be open to what the Spirit of God had to say to them. These were not men and women who had their own agenda, but were really seeking, God, what do you have for us and what lays ahead? As an international church in the midst of a crisis time, I want us to listen for the voice of the Lord as to what our next season looks like. Lord, where are you taking us? How are we to prepare and to respond? Where are you going to lead? What do you want to do in our midst? What are you saying to us through the scripture? What are you saying to us in our times of prayer, personal and corporate? What resonates in our hearts and lives as we come together to share? What is resonating in our heart that the Spirit is saying to us about this next season? I believe it's time for a new season in our church, to be reminded that we are called to take the good news of Jesus to our city as well as our world. We are not here as an expat club for foreigners. There's lots of those. But God has brought people to this city from all over the world because he wants relationship with them. He wants to draw them into his kingdom, forgive their sin, and set them on a path of righteousness. God has something better for so many people. And we need to be asking him, what are those plans? How do we take part in those plans? And what are the plans for us? And how can we continue to minister in the city? What's most effective for reaching people? And so over the next couple of months, we're going to be talking a lot about this. I'm going to call you to a couple of days of corporate prayer and fasting because that's what the early church did. I'm going to call you to some times of discussion. We're inviting everyone that's made Crossroads their home to be part of a small group, small table discussion where we're preparing some questions to ask you about what you think lays ahead and how we can be effective. We want to hear what God is saying to you and what you're sensing. And we're putting together a vision community, the board of elders, along with representatives from different areas of our church, are going to form a vision community, and we're going to be listening to God's word, listening to the response of people. We're going to be praying together and saying, Lord, what do you have for us in these days ahead? And my prayer is that this process will give us a guiding vision for the next 3 years that's fairly focused and specific, the where, the what, the how, that of things we hope to achieve, some strategies that we're going to use and some goals that we're going to have. And it's going to require change, and it means we're going to have to do things differently. But I believe if we ask the Lord, he wants to do something. If we listen, the Spirit will lead and guide us. And I think something beautiful will emerge, mainly lives that are changed for his glory and a church that's built in his honor. And I'm going to be sharing over the next few weeks. We're going to be looking in these scriptures and Acts. And we're just going to be slowly building towards this attitude of, Lord, what do you have for us? How can that become clear? And by the fall, you know, we'll have an understanding of God is leading us in this direction. Here are some initiatives. Here are some things that we need to tackle. Here are some things that we need to do different. And, of course, growth and change means things will be different. And it's not always the same. But again, it's not our church, it's his. And so we're asking him, what do you want to do in your church, Lord? You know, I'm just at a stage maybe in life and a number of years in ministry, I'm just not interested in playing church games anymore. I'm not interested in staying busy for the sake of being busy and shuffling the deck in different ways. I really want to see a fresh move of God. I really want to see his church built up. I really want to see his name glorified. I want to see people come to faith. And I think that's why we're here. And there's many ways to do that, but how is God calling us to do these things in the next few years ahead? That's what I want us to focus into. This church has incredible potential. It is full of great capacity. We have developed a very strong foundation over the years. And now it's time to launch out of that into something new so that we can see the kingdom of God expanded here in our city. We've built up this energy and strength to be used for this time, and I believe God is calling us to something new. And so as we're entering into new territory, seeking God for new direction for our church, it's not about a new message. Our message never changes. Jesus is the hope of the world. We all need to come to him. But we need to make room for the leading of God's Spirit to bring the change that he has for us and believe that he has a vision and a plan, not of our doing, but what he has. And Lord, come and help us discern what that is. And I hope and pray that in the days and weeks ahead, you're going to join me. I just ask you, in your personal prayer time, start praying about these things and asking the Lord, you know, what do you have for Crossroads and what part do you want me to play? Because I believe God is leading us into a new season and a new time, and we should all be excited about what he can do in our midst. Let's pray together. Lord, it's exciting to read of how you built your church and how it grew and how you led people. But Lord, we believe that you're not done building your church. You're building it here in Basel, and you've invited us to be part of that. And Lord, we find ourselves an international community of many different people from all over the world. We find ourselves walking through a COVID crisis. Lord, help us to listen for the voice of your Spirit. Help us to know what the next steps are. Lord, help us to believe that you have a plan and a purpose for this church, that you want to work and unfold. Lord, that we would be faithful to walk in the way that you lead and guide us. And over these next few months, as we just pause to talk with you, to talk with one another, to hear the voice of your Spirit, Lord, I pray that you would be really present with us and that we would learn and grow individually, but especially as a congregation spiritually, for the things that you have us in the day ahead. And Lord, we're excited about that, and we just invite you in. Encourage our hearts. Help us to be quiet and listen to what you have. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for joining us today for our service online. We hope you've been blessed just as we have been. For youth, don't forget to join us in this church today for our evening meeting. We're going to have a great time. So have a good week and God be with you all. Bye-bye.